tonight's main event, the IBF Light Heavyweight Eliminator. The number one ranked IBF lightweight Antonio Tarver takes on number two Eric Harding in tonight's main event from beautiful Biloxi, Mississippi. Let's take a closer look at the two combatants in tonight's main event feature. Boxing is a sport filled with conditions. Tonight we have an elimination bout in the IBF. Antonio Tarver, the 1996 Olympic bronze medalist, is 16-0 with 14 knockouts. The talented 31-year-old out of Orlando, Florida, has a lot of power in his pop. Tarver has won seven consecutive fights by way of knockout, but he's never been past nine rounds. We last saw him here on ESPN2 in August of 1998, taking on Rocky Gannon. A straight left hand in round number two would put Gannon out of his misery. We'll also get a look at the Magic Man, Eric Harding, the Philadelphia native, now fighting out of East Hartford, Connecticut, also unbeaten as a pro. 18-0-1, six knockouts in rank number two by the IBF. Harding is coming off a seven-month layoff. We last saw Harding here on ESPN2 in August of 1998, taking on Dave Hamilton. Harding put him away in round number two. He stepped up in class in November of 1998, taking on Montel Griffin, the only man to hand Roy Jones Jr. his only loss as a professional. It was a tough 12-round bout. Many thought that Griffin had outworked Harding, but Harding got the very tight decision. The prize for these two, a chance at fighting the best fighter arguably in the world. Roy Jones Jr. is the undisputed light heavyweight champion of the world, and these two vying for that elimination spot in the IBF would like a shot at boxing's best.
He's not going to be able to get out of his career without fighting me, because I think that I am the marquee fight for Roy Jones. I think that I am the big fight for Roy Jones.
Well, my main focus is just beating Tarver. And when after that's happened, then I'll concentrate on Roy Jones. And if he decides to move up or vacate the title, then I'll fight whoever is in line fighting for the title.
It's not often that you have a pair of southpaws squaring off with so much at stake.
I know that I have the key to this fight, and that's power. I'm going to press this guy. I'm going to box aggressively. I'm going to lead with my jab. My balance is tremendous. My defense has always been good. I'm going to punch this guy. And when I hit this guy, I know he won't be there.
He's a pretty good puncher. He got a pop in his left hand. And that's what he's looking to set you up with that left hand. The keys to beating him is keep him going back. Don't let him come forward. Keep him backing up and go to his body. And eventually, in the later rounds, he'll wear down.
Eric Harding cannot defeat Antonio Tarver. He hadn't been where I've been. He's not going where I'm going. He's just an obstacle in my way. And after tonight, he won't be there.
Not tonight. Not tonight.
Well, Eric Harding has made his way into the ring here in Biloxi, Mississippi, getting set to take on Antonio Tarver in the IBF Light Heavyweight Eliminator. More on that in just a second. But now it's time for a breakdown on the fight. Teddy Atlas had a chance to talk with both fighters in our main event.
Antonio, both you guys are cuties. Both you guys are slicksters. Both you guys like to counterpunch. I'm going to be Eric Harding. I noticed on the videotape that I watched to him that he likes to use that jab. Sometimes he'll pull with it just to lure his man in, hoping his man will walk right in so he can either count him with the left or maybe count him with the right hook. What are you going to do? Tell our people what you're going to do to make sure that doesn't happen to you.
Well, I'm going to keep my jab busy all night, and as soon as he steps back, I'm going to double up my jab to get my range and maybe beat him the straight left down the pipe.
And make sure you're not there for his left
hand.
Exactly. I noticed on the videotape that your opponent tonight, Eric Harding, throws the jab two different ways. The conventional way from up here, pop, pop. But he'll drop it down here a la Larry Holmes back in the 1980s, where he'll throw it from his hip, pop, pop. What are you going to do if you see that jab coming from here?
Well, I'm definitely going to have to keep my hands up. But I believe if he tailgate his jab that low, he'll be right in fire with my counter left. And that'll be a big mistake for Eric Harding.
Eric, both you guys are defensively really solid. It's not easy to hit either one of you guys. But I noticed with both of this, and I noticed with Antonio Tarver, that when you are able to inch away, get into punching range, that sometimes when you throw that first punch at him, that he'll lean forward this way to his left to get away from that. Now, I know if I was in a corner, what I'd be telling my guy to do. What are you looking at here?
I'm looking at walking right into a right uppercut here.
In other words, you're going to move him into punches, maybe throw a throwaway punch.
Exactly, the move can go right into the punch I really want to hit him with.
That means both of you guys are guys that like to work off of the other guy's mistake. Now, what are you going to do when Antonio's out here? He's waiting for a lead from you so he can make you miss and you can punch. Now, you don't want to stand there too long, but you don't want to leave yourself open to a counter. You don't want to walk into a trap. What are you going to do?
I stay behind my jab and give him some, then take it away and come back on my counters. And I, every time he counters, I come back on my counters. I give him something and take it away from him.
Make sure you're not taking a picture after you punch.
And the intangibles. These guys are mirror images of each other. Who wants it more? Tough has never been past 9 rounds. Will that bother him? This fight might go 12. Both guys will look to counter. Who's going to establish his jab first?
All right, thank you very much, Teddy. And this is the IBF light heavyweight elimination bout. We're joined by Roy Jones Jr.'s promoter, Murad Muhammad. And Roy, it's not often, Murad, it's not often that you have the number one and number two fighting in an elimination bout. It took you to point out to the IBF that this should happen. Explain how this all happened.
Well, I just humbly submitted that this is an excellent formula to create good challenges for Roy Jones Jr. All the sanctioned bodies should do so. If we do this, then we wouldn't have no problem looking for credible opponents. And these two guys are undefeated, and they can fight.
And you pointed out to the IBF that Tarver was ranked number one, and he hadn't beat anybody in the top 15. You said, let him beat somebody first before he should be a mandatory, right?
That is correct. Fighters come into this business for three reasons. To win the title, to make money, and to make more money. They get 3-1 fighting Roy Jones Jr. The opportunity to fight for the title, to make money. If he wins, he makes more money.
So when will Roy fight the winner of this fight?
September the 9th is our target date, and we will sign the winner if the promoters of each athlete, whoever may win the fight, works out a reasonable deal, the fight is on.
Thank you, Murad. Best of luck.
Thank you for having me.
Murad Muhammad explaining why this is an elimination bout. He had a big reason in it happening, pointing out to the IBF that let's have the number one guy at least beat somebody. Eric Harding is ranked number two by the IBF in the light heavyweight division. He is from East Hartford, Connecticut, born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And Eric Harding has not lost in his professional career. Harding has just one draw. As we take a look at his record, 18-0-1, and he has 6 knockouts. And we take a look at his last 5 opponents. And Eric Harding, they have a winning percentage of 79%. The most notable on that list, a split decision win and controversial at that against Montel Griffin back in 1998. Antonio Tarver is the reigning 1996 Olympic bronze medalist. Lost to Vasily Girov. He's 6'2", 174 pounds from Orlando, Florida, 16-0, and he has 14 knockouts in his professional career. His opposition, 69% win percentage. He's coming off a first-round knockout against Ernest Mateen, but he says he's been begging for better competition, and tonight he will get that better competition against a guy in Eric Harding who has a lot of skills, Teddy.
Yes, he will. This is going to be, as I said, these guys are going to feel like they're looking into a mirror, and they might not like what they see, because both guys are looking to do the same thing, not leave themselves open, looking to counter, looking to control the rhythm, and looking to be defensively real cute. This is going to be a chess match.
Here are the rules. Unified rules will be used. No 3 knockdown rule, no standing 8 count. Only the referee can stop it. Accidental cuts, they'll go to the scorecards after 4 rounds are complete. Tarver has won 7 in a row by way of knockout. He's never been past 9, past 7 rounds twice in his professional career, trained by Jimmy Williams. And Al Gavin handles the duties in the Eric Harding camp. Round number 1 underway in what should be a very good fight. And you heard from Roy Jones Jr.'s promoter, Murad Muhammad. The winner definitely gets a shot at the undisputed light heavyweight champion of the world and arguably pound for pound, number one in the world.
Definitely has the makings of an interesting fight, a chess match. Both guys like to do the same thing. Who's going to get to do it?
Knockout ratio, Tarver 14 of 16. He has 2 knockouts past the 6th round. Harding, not a big power puncher with the 6 KOs.
This was a baseball game, Bob. I'm going to use that for an analogy. This would not be like two sluggers like McGuire and Sosa. That's not what you're getting here. This would be more like watching 2 pitchers. And what kind of pitchers? Probably guys like Greg Maddux, Pedro Martinez. A lot of changeups. A lot of trying to hit corners. A chess match.
Harding, who is very, very defensive in the white trunk, says that we will see the most aggressive Eric Harding that we've ever seen before. Now, we've had him here on ESPN2 a handful of times going all the way back to 1996.
This fight might come down to whoever can be a little bit more aggressive will probably have a lead and an edge in this fight.
So how does it feel to do Atlas's world and then do a demonstration and not have me to punch around? Yeah, two live wires in front. I noticed you weren't as brave.
My hands felt better, that's for sure. You know, I drop my hands. I do a lot of commercial stuff with you. But with them, my hands felt, I was more like peekaboo, you know, more like the Customato style. Okay, I keep those hands up. Two nice guys, two articulate guys. Two good boxers. Whoever can be a little bit more aggressive. This might not be a scintillating fight. I'm not gonna lie to you. But if you enjoy watching the finer points, watching someone try to outsmart somebody, somebody trying to set up a guy who's hard to hit, then you're gonna enjoy it.
I've been around Tarver since before the 96 Olympics, doing the Olympic Games in 96, and he had a disappointing loss to Vasily Girov. Controversial loss, but some of Tarver's maybe lack of discipline leading up to that fight hurt him because he had gained some weight in between bouts and might have been his own worst enemy. He held the distinction of being the first American to win the Pan Am, U.S. Nationals, and the World Championship in the same year. That was 1995. A decorated amateur squaring off against a mirror image in Eric Harding. Welcome back to Biloxi. You're watching Friday Night Fights on ESPN2. Bob Papatetti Atlas, the IBF eliminator in the light heavyweight division. Number one, Antonio Tarver in the black trunks. Eric Harding in the white and gold. Ranked number two by the IBF.
Difficult match here. And as I mentioned earlier, whoever can be aggressive without leaving himself open to the other guy's counters will have the edge. And the body, don't forget that body. Especially since both guys move their heads well. Whoever goes to the body, they're gonna help themselves an awful lot.
Tarver landing the most meaningful punches so far.
Good first round for Harding.
The very tentative, very defensive style that Harding has adopted in his career has worked well against the Dave Hamiltons and the Kabari Salines and the Pascal Davids. But he's gonna have to do more than just that slick southpaw, extremely defensive style against a guy like Tarver, because as you move up, you gotta start dealing with the guy's power too.
You have to be busy, you know. The other guys aren't going to, even though you're cute, the other guys are gonna find ways to be aggressive and still not leave themselves open to your strengths, which is counterpunching. They're gonna find ways to work, even if it's not landing all the time. And if they're working and you're not working, you're gonna lose.
Both of these young men have had problems in the past. Harding was actually shot in the leg. He's from Philadelphia. Had a knockout win and a draw to start his career, then a 3.5-year layoff. He was hanging out with the wrong crowd. And one of his trainers and George Cruz, who was handling him at the time, got him out of Philadelphia and relocated him to Hartford. Eric has told us that they saved his life.
Philly has had a lot of great fighters. It's known for that. And a lot of great light heavyweight champs. Harold Johnson, Fatu Saad Muhammad. Funny thing about Harding, he's not your typical Philadelphia fighter.
No.
More of a cutie. Most of those Philadelphia fighters aggressive. Real exciting style. Harding's got a different kind of style. And here is this chess match right here, Bob.
Well, he left that bad crowd in Philadelphia and got his whole life in order. Tarver had dreams of having a basketball scholarship, and when he was in high school, it kind of fell apart. He turned to drugs and cocaine, went to a rehab clinic in Phoenix in 1990, was counseled by Pinklin Thomas, and he turned his life around and went on to be an Olympian. So they've overcome some personal problems early in their lives. They hope to set themselves up for a title shot. Slow pace through the first two. Miller High Life for everyone. Fans relaxing here at the Grand Casino in Biloxi. Round number three underway between Antonio Tarver and Eric Harding. Been a very slow pace. the first two rounds as Harding starts to snap out his jab. The two have landed just 70 of 97 jabs. The two guys that pride themselves on their boxing skills, that is a paltry number. Well, Antonio Tarver feels that he should have had a chance at a championship maybe sooner, you know, especially with guys like Mayweather and Vargas, teammates from the 1996 Olympics, who have moved up the ranks quicker. And Tarver has been a little bit frustrated by what he considers some of the politics in the sport of boxing.
It was obvious that they were trying to avoid me at that time. The rules has nothing to do with it. There's number one contenders, mandatory challenge today with bogus records. You know, I've earned my keeps. I've represented this country. I was one of the best amateurs, arguably, in the world, in history of the game. I'm 16-0 with 14 KOs. I mean, I begged to fight those guys coming up. No one would take me on as a challenger. And you, being a former promoter of mine, can vouch for me on that. And now that I'm number one, you know, they want me to fight number two contenders, number three contenders. You tell me one number one challenger or contender out there that's fighting top five guys. You know, it's not happening. But I'm not shying away from this challenge. I'm up for this challenge because it'll give me an opportunity to prove that I belong and that I'm here.
But in all fairness, they weren't asking them to fight top five guys. Top 15 guys they were asking them to fight. That's the rule.
Well, he's in a difficult fight tonight. And we said earlier, whoever can be aggressive, whoever can go to the body, can have a lead. And right now, that's Mr. Harding. He's being a little bit more aggressive, and he's working to that body.
Yeah, Harding is having a very good round three, Teddy.
There's three things in this fight here. One is who can establish a jab, who can find the way to be aggressive against the other guy who is defensively looking to do mostly countering, and who can go to the body.
Neither guy has done a good job establishing the jab, but Harding is outworking Tarver on the inside, Ted.
The key is Harding did not even have to use a jab to get in there. He didn't have to jab, he's in there. And right now, the funny thing about it, he's working like the stronger guy. And he's really the smaller guy. Turned pro as a middleweight. Tarver's been a light heavyweight his whole career. Last four fights, 178 pounds or 179 pounds. Harding's been as low as 169.
Eric Harding, probably in the most decisive round of the fight. Friday Night Fights on ESPN2 is presented by Miller High Life. Gorgeous sun splash day on the Gulf Coast in Biloxi. Glad you can join us. And we take a look at the IBF rankings in the light heavyweight division. You see Tarver and Harding 1 and 2. The winner of this fight guaranteed to get a shot against Roy Jones Jr., arguably in the first week of September. You see Jones dominates. The fight that people would like to see is Jones against Darius Mikulchevsky, the WBO champion, but he's not going to leave Germany, and it appears that Roy Jones does not want to go to Germany.
And that's probably where the fight should be, in Germany, because it's a much bigger, as great as Jones is, it's a much, much bigger fight in Germany.
And Jones rightfully so feels that he could get robbed if he goes there, and that's many fighters who go there tend to get robbed. You basically have to knock the guy out to win there.
And also the money, Bob. The money, even though it sounds like big money, around $10 million, Jones knows there's more money in Germany. He knows the ratings they do on TV, that it's incredible.
Well, after Harding opened up in round three, Tarver opening up here in round four.
Well, after that last round, he got a little bit of a call, a wake-up call. And if you want to go to that next point, you have to make a choice. Right now, Tarver's making a choice. We said it, whoever's going to find the way to be the aggressor is going to be the king in this fight. Last round was Harding. This round, guess what? It's the other guy. See, Antonio's doing a smart thing there. He's got a cute guy in front of him, moves his head well. Antonio was following his head that time, putting punches together. Even though they weren't all landing, just kept touching them, kept moving his hands, moving them into punches. Good job by Antonio Tarver. He figures if he keeps pressure on Harding, he won't allow Harding to counter and use his cuteness. Right now, Antonio's taking what's given to him.
Well, Harding stepped up the aggression in round three. And here in round four, Tarver is the one who is pressing the action.
You want to see if Tarver can keep it up.
Nice uppercut on the inside by Harding after a good body shot from Tarver.
See, Harding don't have to worry. Harding can say to himself, maybe I'll let Tarver pick spots. Because he's the guy who hasn't been past nine rounds. Harding, of course, has been 10 rounds once, 12 rounds once. So maybe Harding can say, hey, let this guy spend himself a little bit and hit down himself later in the fight.
They hit the body by Tarver.
He used a jab to make Harding cover up.
And he faked to the body and went up top.
Hey, you're becoming a half a trainer there. You're learning there, kid. Exactly what he did.
Thank you.
But you're right, you saw it.
Well, a better round four for Antonio Tarver after Harding had a pretty good round three. Scheduled for 12.
Well, Tarver knows what to do when you have a man leaning forward on you. Throw that uppercut. And that's exactly what Tarver lands with. Then he tries to follow upstairs, but nothing much there with the good defense of Harding, but good uppercut by Tarver.
Round five underway in the scheduled 12 rounder. Harding in the white, Tarver in the black. A nondescript, boring first two rounds. Round three, a good round for Harding. Round four, a good round for Tarver as things pick up. Now Harding lets the straight left hand go. We'll take a look at the punch numbers through four rounds. And Tarver landing single digits in each of the first three. He landed 20 of 90 in round four.
You love the science, the sweet part of the science of boxing. You're a boxing aficionado. You have to like this fight so far. Started off a little bit slow, but both guys are looking not to leave themselves open and still find a way to be aggressive. It's interesting.
All right, let's go, break it. Step back.
And it's not easy. Both guys are not only defensively real good, but countering is a strong part of their arsenal. So you don't want to leave yourself open.
Now Harding working off the jab effectively.
Whoever uses that jab, whoever can find a way to be aggressive, whoever goes to the body, they're going to win that round. And so far, that's how each one has taken turns winning the round. So here's the trick right now. Setting up real quick. Harding wants to press behind that jab, but he wants to do it in a way where he doesn't leave himself open. So every once in a while, he'll wait, he'll think a little bit, make sure he's at the right range. Doesn't want to leave himself open for a counter. And there's the counter from Tarver. See, Tarver was looking for that counter all along.
Teddy has it dead even, and now Tarver opening up.
He was looking for that. He's like a cobra here.
Harding has carried most of the round, but now Tarver trying to come on and steal it.
See, that's why neither guy, well, even when they're using the jab, they're thoughtful with it. Because they know the other guy's always looking to take that jab and make it into a mistake.
Jab is great, Bob.
But a jab can be countered. You have to make sure when you throw your jab, especially when you're in there with a slickster, you don't leave yourself open. Look how careful these guys are on offense. When they throw, they want to be perfect on their distance, perfect on their form. If they hang there a little too long, they're going to get counted.
Well, with the exception of a short spurt, I think Harding has pretty much carried this round.
He has carried most of the rhythm, most of the action, most of the flow. There was spots for Tarver, though. Good hard spots.
Good round five for both. We begin round number six. Round five, an intriguing round, depending on how you look at things. This is a scheduled 12-round light heavyweight IBF eliminator between Antonio Tarver, ranked number one, and Eric Harding, ranked number two. Very interesting. Both guys have struggled with their jab. Harding has landed 9 of 106 jabs through five rounds. Tarver, 11 of 109. And I mentioned round five was close. You take a look at the numbers. They each land 11 punches. But Harding did throw 18 more. So did you like Carver's power or Harding's being busy?
Very good point. And because of that, it even needs thing up. The power was there. The harder punch was landed by Tarver. The more active guy was Harding. And therefore, believe it or not, I came up with an even round.
As Pennsylvania Boxing Commissioner Greg Serb cringes with yet another even Teddy Atlas round. He would do horrible in his rankings.
Hey, Greg, you know.
I gave it to Harding. I thought he carried most of the 3 minutes.
But I'm trying not to have too many even rounds. This fight can be a test of that. Well, I was mentioning the bigger guy before. I didn't finish my point, but Harding, the smaller man, 11 of his 18 fights at 169 pounds or less. And as I said, the bigger guy, Tarver, always been a light heavyweight. Matter of fact, you mentioned it. He had trouble making weight in the Olympics, had to lose weight. But it doesn't seem to show here. Tarver doesn't have a distinct advantage as the bigger guy. And if he doesn't, on the inside, that is. And if he doesn't, that might not bode well for him. Because on the inside, on the outside, it's going to be tough. It's going to be close. So you would think Tarver would want to have an edge on the inside. If he doesn't have that edge on the inside, boy, it's going to be a tough, tough fight.
Amoedov wants a little towel. The ring a little wet, doesn't want the boxer slipping. And he asked for a dry towel, which normally helps. Now, the thing about Tarver is, you know he has some power, but you wonder how much power he has. He's kind of, he's got that Harding cutiness to him, but you wonder, is he really a power guy? It's almost like he's in between styles.
Here's a good point. He can't win this fight just as a power guy tonight. Maybe you make me wrong, he'll get lucky, he'll catch him. But really the percentages are he can't fight like a power guy. He's gotta be busy, he's gotta be consistent, because you're not gonna land a big punch against Harding, who's been defensively real cute his whole career. You can't depend on that. You can't fight that way. Because if you do, you're going to get too far behind the eight ball. And then you're going to need the one big punch. And you don't want to need a big punch with a cutie like Harding.
20 seconds to go.
It's the war of the, it's the battle of the body. Both guys know the head is hard to find. The battle of the body.
There's Harding with a combination to the body. Tarver slapping with those punches as he misses to end the round.
Two big points, that jab and the body attack. Well, there was the jab by Tarver, and here comes the body attack. And this is what they call shoe shining. And you know what? Shoe shining in this fight can win a round. That's how close the rounds are.
Harding did a good job of going to the body at points in that round. It's a real chess match between two guys with very similar styles. Antonio Tarver in the black, Eric Harding in the white. Tarver, a highly decorated amateur, dominant in the amateur game, especially in 1995, even in 96, before being upset in the Olympics. And we go to the corner of Antonio Tarver and his longtime trainer and friend, Jimmy Williams. Jimmy, Bob Papa, Teddy Atlas, how do you see this fight unfolding? Is it going the way you had planned?
Well, you know, he's surprised. He's standing up. I thought he was going to run, but he's trying to fight inside, which is good. Is that I'm trying to get Tony to go to his body more. I'm just trying to get him to go to the body.
Jimmy, has your guy Antonio been thrown off a little bit by Harding coming at him?
Yeah, it was a different little thing, but that's okay though. But yeah, because he's noted for running all the time, but it's beautiful. That's okay. We'll catch up with him.
As long as your guy starts punching a little bit more on the inside.
Right? Tony's been trying to set him up. I told him, no, if the knockout comes, let it come.
Jimmy, thank you and best of luck.
Thank you.
Good luck, Jim.
Yeah. All right.
So they were a bit surprised by Harding's aggression.
That can throw a guy off, huh? You can train thinking that the guy's going to move, going to run from you. And all of a sudden, you're mentally not prepared for a guy to pressure.
But Teddy, at this level of competition, at this stage,
you got to be prepared.
Well, I mean,
yes, you're right.
It might shock you in the first one or two.
You have to adjust, like Mosley adjusted in his fight plan last week to win that fight against De La Hoya. He fought with De La Hoya for six rounds, and then he made an adjustment. That was the difference.
Tarver faced a lot of southpaws in the amateur game.
One of the greatest amateurs, maybe in American history, right up there with guys like Mark Whelan, Howard Davis Jr. Matter of fact, in 95, Tarver became the first boxer, as you mentioned before, to win the world championship, the U.S. championship, and the Pan Am game the same year. Five-time national U.S. champion, Tarver. This is not three rounds.
Nope. No headgear and no computerized scoring. Whole different ballgame.
Both guys are looking to use those pouring jabs to set up the left hand. And guess what? Tarver beat Harding to the mark. Beat him to the punch. Smart move there, Bob. Harding was looking for the setup. He's looking to pour, looking to walk Tarver into something. Tarver fired the left hand, beat him to it.
Well, seven rounds are complete, and you can make the case that three of those rounds, three of the seven, were very hard to score. So who knows what the judges' scorecards could be.
What's the jab of Harding? He's got two kinds of jabs. Right now he's using the second one, from the hip. From the hip. Now, we talked about this in a setup, in a pre-fight setup. If Tarver can inch his way, can sneak his way into punching distance, he can time his left hand over that jab. He's late that time. He's got to throw it just as Harding starts to throw his punch. Too soon, he misses. Too late, he gets hit. Kind of like a baseball player standing at that plate trying to hit that curveball. Got to wait till the last second. Last second, even though it looks like it's going to hit you, wait till the last second. When it shows itself, then get your hands around. You have to have discipline. You have to have faith. Confidence.
Both guys a bit fatigued. I'm going to check in with Eric Harding's corner and Al Gavin, who is arguably one of the best cut men in the world and an excellent trainer in his own right as well. Al, Bob, and Teddy here ringside. Are you pleased with what Eric has done so far?
Not at this point, I'm not. Before I am. As long as he's backing this guy up, he can't do much.
Al, this is Teddy. I agree with you, Al. I think this fight comes down to a real simple thing right
now.
Who wants it more?
We want it, Eric! There's your answer, Teddy. Punch! Eric, don't let him steal rounds. Come on. Busy!
This is going to come down to who works a little harder, who throws those extra punches right now.
And who's done that running in the country up in Pennsylvania. And we did it. Eric, you got a punch!
Left hand by Tarver. Al, a lot of these rounds very close,
yes,
too.
Yes, I realize that.
Couple extra punches, Al. Any one of these rounds can carry around.
You're right, Eddie. I'm sorry. He just got to get busy. Now we go!
Tarver has outlanded Harding 13-1, according to CompuBox, for the first 2 minutes of this round. Thank you, Al Gavin, and best of luck. And
luck.
Made a great point. The guys that put in that extra time conditioning, that might tell the story.
Right now, the guy carrying this round so far has been Tarver. Harding pushed, he pressed, but he didn't move those hands the way that his trainer, Al Gavin, wanted him to. Now Gavin has been around. Been around New York, terrific trainer, terrific cut man.
Well, a very good round eight for Antonio Tarver as Harding tries to respond late. Very even through eight. Here's Brian and Max.
Hey, Max, I think this is a good level of progression fight, and this is why you want these guys squaring off before they get to Roy Jones Jr., but at this point, is Roy very worried with what he's looking at so far?
I don't think Roy's worried with anything, really. I mean, he's Roy Jones. He's incredible. But, you know, you look at this fight, Antonio Tarver has had his way with his 16 opponents in his professional career so far because he really hasn't been in with anyone. Now he's in with someone. You see, it's a much closer fight. But I'm impressed with what I see so far, both world-class fighters.
Absolutely. Programming note coming your way tomorrow. Hockey fans, get ready for this. It's the NHL Draft, Saturday, noon Eastern time. You can see it on ESPN2. The Islanders get the first selection. You got the Minnesota Wild and the Columbus Blue Jackets as well. Who knew? Right now, back to the light heavyweight title eliminator, Tarver and Harding. Gentlemen.
Thank you, Brian. As Murad Muhammad, Roy Jones promoter, told us earlier, it will be or is scheduled to be in September, first week of September. The winner of this fight will battle Roy Jones for the light heavyweight championship. And fairly even fight, Teddy, through eight rounds. I mean, some of those rounds too close to call, as they'd say in an election year, but round eight was a very good round for Tark.
This is a fight that's either even or one point fight, either way, I believe.
Keith Hughes, Fred Steinwander III, and Johnny Femia are your judges, along with Elmo Adolph, your referee. You see the numbers, 23 landed, 19 were power shots by Carver. And those guys that I mentioned that are the judges are also part of that outstanding referee crew here on the Gulf Coast that work Louisiana and Mississippi. So I think the scoring is in pretty good hands. We'll get a fair shake.
Well, if you go by that first fight we had, it's in good hands. They did a good job. Hey, when you have a close, tough fight that we knew this would be, what do you get, Bob? You get ebbs and flows. You get one guy going, another guy going. That's exactly what's happening every round. They're taking turns. Last round was tougher. This round started off hardy. You know, he got a pep talk from Al Gavin. Al Gavin, the cut man for heavyweight champ Lennox Lewis. Well, it's another good trainer we talked to already. Jimmy Williams, been around for years. Real good teacher. Antonio Tarver's man.
Not very powerful shot from Harding, but coming in bunches and Tarver inactive, and that catches the judge's eyes. Teddy Atlas's scorecard through eight, 77-76 for Tarver. By way of that even round, I have it dead even at 76 off.
The busier guy, the hungrier guy this round, so far, Harding. But you see what Tarver's doing? He's looking for a counter opportunity. But meanwhile, he's losing the round, looking for it. He's looking to punch inside one of those punches, right there. He was able to catch Harding's right hook, but Harding came right back.
Now Tarver looks to open up.
Yeah, Tarver's looking for a spot here. His eyes are open. He's looking for a spot, Bob.
Good body shot there by Harding, though.
Harding's going to the right spot. We talked about it. The body. That's the spot to go with both these guys.
Left hands to the rib cage by Harding have been effective right there.
Not only do you score points, but you can take away some of that elusive ability later on in the fight.
And Tarver has been non-existent in this round. A wild miss with the left as he tried to land that bomb.
Tarver's looking for one shot, a little too much. He's looking to punch inside these punches of Harding. If he doesn't catch something big, which he might, but if he doesn't, he's going to lose the round.
Good left hand by Tarver.
He's looking for a spot, Tarver.
Harding's chin is sitting out there, Teddy.
But Harding is smart. He's smothering Tarver. He's staying real close, not giving Tarver room to punch.
The normally passive Eric Harding willing to slug with Tarver.
Good fight. Well, in this kind of fight, when push comes to shove, who wants it more? Who's going to move their hands? And Tarver was trying to pull out in spots, but Harding was coming right back.
Well, Eric Harding has been willing to trade tonight. That is not his trademark. Round 10 underway. Remember, this is a 12-round bout. IBF light heavyweight eliminator bout. Number one ranked Tarver, number two ranked Harding.
Good fight, Bob. Good, interesting fight. You got both the best of both worlds. Cleverness, guys that just don't walk into punches, and they're fighting. These guys are going after it.
See the punch numbers from round nine. Harding throwing 57 more punches. 100 to 43. Joe Carnicelli, Saul Avila, CompuBox tonight.
He said that this would be a chess match, but you know what? Both these guys are starting to move their pawns forward real fast.
But it seems sometimes, though, when Harding is hooking to the body on the inside there, he kind of leaves his head leaning forward and his jaw up. You just get the feeling that if Tarver can just nail it, Harding's in trouble.
That's a good point. Tarver's looking to nail it with his counter-punching mentality, but that can be a trap for him, too. Because if he looks to nail it, he can get out-hustled. Harding has a good chin. If he doesn't knock out Harding, he could find himself behind on the scorecards. He doesn't want to fall into that trap. He wants to lead and get the counter. If he wants to lead, use his jab, be busy, and also be able to counter. Do both.
see Tarver takes a little breath there. I think that some of those body punches are starting to tell a tale.
They might be, or Tarver might be playing possum a little bit. Trying to draw Harding. It's not easy to draw him in.
Tarver again looking for that chin and not finding it.
He's looking to load up on that left hand. If you look real close at the feet, our camera guy is always doing a great job there. If you look at the feet of Tarver, you see most of his weight's back on his left foot. Watch his right foot, it's very light. That means he's looking for that left hand. There it is.
There's Harding again hooking to the body.
That means Harding can take advantage of that, and he is.
Harding getting in some good shots here on Tarver.
Right now, if you look at the feet of Tarver, they're moving too much. He's not set to punch. And that's why Harding's able to move his hands.
Eric Harding, who is not known for his heavy hands, has slowed down Antonio Tarver with some power shots of his own here in round 10.
There's that body.
Eric Harding looking to take control.
Well, Bob, we talked about the intangibles. Both guys have been mirror images of each other. They're going back and forth. It's real tight. And is Tarver going to fade a little bit in these rounds? We're finding out right now. He didn't look too good in that last round. And who can establish the jab we talked about? Both guys would be looking for the counter. Whoever's pressed behind the jab, they've been able to get inside. That body attack has been a big part of this fight.
Well, I mentioned in the last round a combination to the body by Harding, and you saw Tarver take a deep breath, and we wondered if maybe he was playing possum, but the way that round ended, I don't think he was playing possum. I think it bothered him. Very close fight through 10. Get a look at the footwork. Director Lenny Stucker, producer Rob Beiner. Teddy, I have Harding by 2 going into these last two rounds. I know you have it a little closer.
Yeah, I have Harding by 1. Either way.
And remember, there are about 4 rounds through the first 10, maybe even 5, that are razor thin.
Watch when Tarver's moving his feet, Bob. Every time he moves his feet, Harding can walk right in.
Harding not a big puncher, slaps a lot, but he's throwing numerous punches, and he's got Tarver on the retreat.
Don't forget, this is no man's land for Mr. Tarver, and Harding knows it. He's been there before. Tarver hasn't.
There's another hook to the body, effective for Harding.
Who wants it more?
Hey, I think if Harding wins this fight, you'll have to look to all those hooks to the body as a key factor in this thing.
And one other thing, he's fought the better fighters on his record. He's been in a real fight. He's been in there with Montel Griffith, a close, controversial fight. He took on Jorge Dolan, but he's been in a tough fight.
Good left hand by Harding.
Tarver has not been in any tough fights. This is his first tough fight. That is very, very, very important.
Yeah, because the one name that he had was Rocky Gannon, but that was it for Rocky Gannon. We had that here on ESPN2 and back in 1998, but Gannon was not the same workman-like guy. He was at the end of the line.
Look at the difference of the two guys. You can say condition, but how much of it's mental? How much is it a guy who says, I've been in here, I can handle it, and another guy who maybe is not sure that he can? Very important not to feed guys too many soft guys on the way up. You have to have a fight where you take a deep breath before you get in the real fight. You have to.
Brian and Max alluded to it earlier about Roy Jones probably watching. I'm sure Roy is not losing any sleep over either of these two.
Although style-wise, either one of these guys would be present a chance for it to be much more competitive with a Roy Jones, because both guys are smart, they're cute, they're not just going to walk into a punch.
Well, Eric Harding in the late rounds is taking control, and Tarver goes down! Tarver went down, he was leaning against the ropes. That is a knockdown, and then Harding popped him because the referee, Elmo Adolf, really didn't jump in. But that's a knockdown, and in a fight this close, a two-point round could be huge.
What we say, who wants it more? Right now, Tarver's breaking down. Never been in a tough fight. Right there, it looked like he was breaking down.
Teddy, we get a look at the knockdown here. Eric Harding putting his punches together.
They're not clean punches,
I think what happens is he gives in a little bit. Quite honestly, he looked like he just broke down mentally.
And now they're waiting to get the mouthpiece in. Carver's mouth, and now they call a timeout because he loses the mouthpiece.
Is he stalling for time? I'd say it's a good chance, right?
I think he's stalling. The body punch in round number 10, he started to shake his head.
Good chance he's stalling for time. Matter of fact, he is stalling for time.
Why do we say that? Well, the way the round ended.
Time! Carver keeps losing his mouth. I don't understand
that. He lost it again. The way for us to be able to say that we think that he's breaking down and that he's stalling for time is because of what happened at the end of the round. The round started breaking down. He was looking for more time.
All right, he was spinning it out because they put the wrong mouthpiece in, not the one that he had been using. And he wanted the mouthpiece that he's been using. But I think those body punches in round 10 told a story. When he took that deep breath inside, he gets knocked down in round number 11, and now he's looking to buy any opportunity he can.
Either it was one of two things. Either his corner was smart and looking for a way to save time, or he's just breaking down. And it looks right now like he's breaking down, unless he's looking for a big home run somewhere. But
well,
he's going the wrong way right now, downhill.
Last three rounds, you take a look at the punch numbers, and Tarver is in deep trouble.
Tarver's never been in a tough fight, as we said before. And you know what? Right now, he wishes he was.
And the one tough fight he was in the Olympics, he lost to Vasily Girov.
A southpaw, and an aggressive southpaw. And now, of course, cruiserweight champ of the world.
Antonio Tarver, despite all the amateur medals and awards, had the huge disappointment in Atlanta, came up short against Girov, has a padded 16-0 record with 14 knockouts, but in his first step up in class, he is really struggling against Eric Harding. Not known for his power, but he's dropped Tarver once in round 11, and he's just breaking his will, Teddy. That's what it appears to my novice eyes.
Well, your novice eyes aren't that novice. You've been around, you've been watching fights a long time,
but what do you see in the guy's fighter's eyes?
I see in his actions. In his actions, I see a guy who has never been in a big fight, a tough fight, I should say, a contested fight, and he's doubting himself, he's falling apart, he's having trouble hanging in there.
And Eric Harding wants a chance to fight Roy Jones Jr. He is fighting the last three, four rounds like he can taste the opportunity.
I see a guy in Tarver who right now is thinking the wrong way. And the ability to think the right way is having been in tougher fights.
Tarver has not landed a punch yet in this round, according to CompuBox. Hasn't thrown men. He's in a full retreat mode. There is no sense of urgency right now, knowing that he got dropped in round 11, that he's got to open up. It looks like he's just trying to not get knocked out, Teddy.
Trying to survive. And right now, if there's a little bit of a knock, you could on Harding, and it's hard to knock him, but he should be stepping it up. I know it's not his temperament. He's not a finisher, but he should be stepping it up. He's got a guy who wants to maybe get out. Well, give him a way to get out.
Harding,
give him an excuse to get out.
Just pounding Antonio Tarver. And Tarver is more than willing to let Harding perform on him. I have a sweep in the last four rounds for Eric Harding in a close fight. He dropped Tarver in round 11, and it looks like Eric Harding is going to get the September date against boxing's best, Roy Jones Jr. According to CompuBox, Tarver didn't land a punch in the last round. Antonio Tarver disappointed, Eric Harding joyous. The judges' cards after this. ESPN2 has been presented by Miller High Life. And in part by Grecian 5, a new generation of hair color for a new generation of man. Back in Biloxi, Mississippi. And shrimp, shrimp, more shrimp. Get your shrimp. And you see the total punch numbers. You see that Tarver actually landed more. How about this, Teddy? In round 12, Tarver was 0 for 13. He only threw one power shot in that last round. Teddy Atlas's scorecard, we take a look at it. And we get a look at your final numbers. 116-112. You gave Harding the last four, so did I. Have it 116-111. Here is Ed Darien with the judges' card.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the Grand Casino here in Biloxi, Mississippi, I've got the scoring. But before that, fans, remember, the winner of this fight goes on to fight world champion, Roy Jones Jr. All three judges, Fred Steinwinder III, Keith Hughes, and John Femia, each score 116-111. All for the winner by unanimous decision, and he goes on to fight Roy Jones Jr., Eric Magic 2000 Hardy.
Well, Teddy, they had like my card, 116-111, and I said earlier, Keith Hughes, Johnny Femia, Fred Steinwinder III, these guys here on the Gulf Coast are excellent judges and refs, and they got it exactly the way this fight turned out.
Well, they proved it. They proved it twice tonight. In two fights that were fairly close, could have been controversy, no controversy, they did a good job.
So Eric Harding wins the eliminator. We'll talk to him, but first let's check in with Brian and Max.
Always a guy behind the scenes going, come on, bring it on. And you're like, hey, wee, easy go. It reminds me now like Shane Mosley when he won the title and he had number one contender there saying, well, maybe I don't want to fight him just now, just yet. It didn't happen. No, it wasn't Vernon.
Oh, you're talking about the number one contender.
Yeah, you don't want to fight him right away.
It's not going to be pretty what he's going to do to Harding. However, I framed this as the Antonio Tarver story, and it turned out to be the Eric Harding story, and we have to make amends, at least I do, to Harding right now. Tremendous win. Tarver started to do a little bit better in the middle rounds in a close fight, and then Harding took over the fight. I think the experience told and the desire told in this fight. Tarver showed a lot of class after the fight, but it was the Eric Harding story here tonight, and I did him a disservice by focusing on Tarver and excluding him. He won the fight. He's earned a shot at Roy Jones.
You were talking about star quality and that sort of thing, and you get in the ring, and of course it's going to be settled in the ring. And again, this level of progression, both of these guys are better off having fought each other, especially Tarver now, too.
Yeah, I know you're a big believer in that, and you're right, of course. You can't. Why don't guys just turn pro and fight for titles? It's not the way it happens, hardly ever, except against your boy Floyd Patterson once. But hardly ever happens. You need experience. There are levels of progression. You think everyone talking about experience is just to sound good. It's not. It showed in this fight. Tarver's never been in with anyone. Harding survived to win an unpopular but a close decision against Montel Griffin, a world-class guy. And the experience helped him here.
Eric Harding gets his shot at the title against Roy Jones Jr. Harding standing by with Bob Papa and Teddy Atlas. Fellas, take it away.
All right, thank you very much, Brian and Max. We've had Eric Harding here on ESPN2 going all the way back to 1997-96. Your best performance. You said you were thinking about something coming into this fight. If somebody else can do it, you can do it. Tell the story.
Well, after the sixth round, all I can think about was Shane Mosley. I picked Shane over Oscar, and he showed me after the sixth round that he can just come back and he can take over. So in the corner of the sixth round, I said to myself, if the Lakers can come back from in the seventh game, and mostly you can do it, just suck it up and you can do it. And I just willed myself to take over.
Eric, we said from the beginning that this was a fight of two guys that were cute. Whoever went to the body first and most would have a big edge. You went to the body. Was that the big difference in this fight?
Yeah, we trained on Al Gavin and training camp. Al Gavin and Eddie Triano, Moses, we worked on body for the 6 weeks we did training camp. We knew we had to weigh this guy down. He a cute puncher. I mean, he a cute boxer with some pop on his punches. That he tried to hit you with that, set you up with that left hand. So we figured we take him into the late rounds. I've been 12 rounds. I figure I wear him down about six rounds and just come on strong in the later rounds.
All right, Eric, you had a tough time in Philadelphia. You moved to Connecticut. You've turned your life around. Now you're going to fight for the world championship. Can you put it in words?
Nah, I really can't. I mean, I didn't think about it until just now when you said it. It was like, wow, I always dreamed of fighting for the title, but my quest is not over. I got to win it. Just fighting for it is not good enough. I got one more hurdle to go over.
Congratulations, Eric, on a great performance. Unanimous decision against Antonio Tarver. Eric Harding is moving on. He'll take on Roy Jones in September for the IBF Lightweight Heavyweight Championship. Here's Brian and Max.
Bob, thank you very much, and congratulations to Harding again.
How could you not root for a guy like that? How could you not root for a guy like that?
Meantime, we've been talking about this with Roy Jones and the pound-for-pound ratings and Sugar Shane on the way up. Max, you've got new rankings.
Yes, I do. You know, Stevie Johnston lost. We're going to start from the top. Look, Shane Mosley is the first guy to put pressure on Roy Jones for that number one spot. And don't make a mistake. There is pressure here. Mosley just dominated De La Hoya in a competitive fight, but dominated. He moves ahead of Trinidad because, look, I just saw De La Hoya box Trinidad's ears off for most of that fight, and then Mosley beat De La Hoya with at least as much ease as De La Hoya, I felt, beat Trinidad. Then Floyd Mayweather drops from inactivity. De La Hoya fought a great fight against Mosley. I think he deserves not to drop so much. He drops one spot. Ricardo Lopez stays the same. Hamed stays the same. Vargas stays the same, although Vargas Trinidad, another great fight that could happen this year. Vargas might move way up there into the top three if he beats Trinidad.
Bernard Hopkins stays the same. And then 10, Stevie Johnson drops out. I can't put Barrera in ahead of Morales. I think Morales is a more effective fighter against more different styles of fighters. And I can't put Morales in. Barrera, I felt, beat him. So who do I put in? Lennox Lewis.
Speaking of heavyweights, we'll get into a quick point here about Mike Tyson against Lew Severies. 12 years ago, I'm at a press conference. Lew Severies is on the undercard. I'm there. I've been training in Tyson's camp at the time. And Lew says, boy, I'd love to get a shot at Mike Tyson. I'm thinking, Lew, what are you thinking? You don't want to get cut up by my guy. And now, 12 years later, he's got a better shot, but I think he's made to order for Tyson. Standing there straight up, he probably beat Orlin Norris. Norris would probably beat Mike Tyson, but he's not beating Mike Tyson tomorrow night, I don't think.
I don't know if Norris would beat Mike Tyson. It was an even first round, but you're right, Lou is made to order. That's why he's there. I'm excited about my man Zab Judah on the undercard. Zab Judah's making the first title, his first title defense. I think ultimately he may be the most interesting challenge to Shane Mosley out there a year or two down the road.
Down the road. Meantime, next week here on Friday Night Fights, we watch another guy. We're talking about Vivian Harris. Before, we had Harris and Judah. Hey, Ray Oliveira is the guy that beat Vivian Harris. He's in our main event next week, taking on Isaac Cruz. That's next Friday night, right here, Friday Night Fights, 9 Eastern Time. For Max Kellerman, Bob Papa, and Teddy Atlas, I'm Brian Kenny. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of the Go Network. Go.com.